He received his PhD from the University of Chicago in 1997. And now I'd like to welcome Sudhir Venkatesh to the podium to begin tonight's program. Thank you all for coming.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming out, spending a little time with me. You all look very small. It's so wonderful to be back here in Chicago. I am not a student of cities. I grew up in a lovely suburb where no one broke the law. Everyone did everything the right way. At least that's what they told me. And then I came to Chicago, where everyone voted twice. And then I left Chicago, and I regret it ever since. And as some, I just saw someone my way of saying it is, I just happened to change my residence, but I'm still living in Chicago. So it's a real pleasure to come back. It's been a long time since I've had a chance to be here. This book is about New York, and it's about New York from this, by someone who felt as though everywhere in the world was basically like Chicago. And if there are places in the world that weren't like Chicago, well, that's their damn fault. They should change. It was an attempt to try to figure out what the city was like in New York. And I don't know if you can, we have a whole bunch of different people in different stages of their life, but I'm not sure if you can kind of recall New York in the early, and New York or Chicago in the early 1990s, mid-1990s, late 1990s. Maybe some of you were around here around that time period. It felt a little different. It certainly feels different to me. It was a different kind of a city. When I arrived in New York, I was trying to make sense of it. I arrived in 1999. I had gotten a degree from the University of Chicago, and then I was trying to figure out how do you make sense of a new city. And this book is really a 270-some page lesson in failure, really, and picking yourself back up and just trying to make sense of it over and over and over and again. I'd like to just share with you a little bit about my struggles in New York and what I was trying to do, and read you three little passages from this book. And before I do, since it's at the University of Chicago, it wouldn't be a University of Chicago, or we're in the University of Chicago environment, it wouldn't be a U of C event unless I gave you some homework. So my homework for you is the following, which is, this book is about the underground economy. And I'd like to know, maybe when you, if you ask a question later, I'd like you to think about and then tell me what you think the underground economy is. When I say those two words, underground economy, what comes up in your mind? And specifically, what I want you to think about is that currently there is an economy, an industry in New York that made one company, not even just the industry, one company, one business, let's say, I'm not going to say whether it's legal or not, one business made $78 million to the degree that we can estimate it because it's underground, about $78 million last year in New York. And probably less than 1% of that was paid in taxes. So they're getting away with making a lot of money. And if you can guess what that business is, I'd be curious, and I'll tell you what that is at toward the end of the talk. But what I want to do is talk about what it means for somebody to come and try to study New York from the perspective of being from Chicago. And specifically, around this time, New York and Chicago were both changing in that they were becoming very gentrified. They were becoming these so-called global cities where people wanted to come back and live in the city from the suburbs. They were becoming very exciting places. And most people who studied that went to what I call the skyscrapers. They looked at real estate. They looked at all the people making a lot of money. They looked at music, food, all the places where different cultures combine. But I wanted to ask the question, what if you looked in the alleyways at people who were doing things off the books, people who were doing things illegally, who weren't being noticed? Would you still find a global city? And what would that mean? So let me start with just reading a little bit about what this was like for me, again, as someone coming from Chicago and landing in New York. My own background from Chicago was hobbling me. Like it or not, as a Chicago sociologist, I had internalized the idea that the Chicago style of urban living was universal, that everyone stayed in their neighborhoods, that people stayed in neighborhoods segregated by race and class, blacks stayed with blacks, whites stayed with whites, poor were separated from rich, and their children lived in the same way, the patterns passed down generations after generation. Now that was a setting that was handmade for a sociologist. All an eager, aspiring young sociologist had to do was hang out long enough for the locals to tell you, to let you into their lives. And I'm going to talk about one person in the beginning that I met named Shine, who was a crack dealer in Chicago, in New York. And so I'm going to refer to him a little bit. Shine wanted me to get out of the Chicago mode. Shine had been telling me since our very first meeting in New York to get into a car and drive around the city and get a feeling for the immensity of New York, the huge variety of communities and peoples and neighborhoods. But the truth was, despite all my own concerns about the transition from Chicago and my tentative steps into the rich varieties of worlds contained in New York, going to all these neighborhoods, broad and shallow, was just not my style. I really did believe that you should find a place, hang out, get to know the people, and keep coming back. But Shine kept pushing me. You need to move. You need to move around, you understand? I keep telling you, but you don't listen. Shine was pointing me away from the idea of unchanging lives that people held in their little neighborhoods. Instead of drawing boundaries, he said, people in New York were crossing boundaries. Instead of looking for places to anchor their work, they were pulling up anchors and putting them down in another neighborhood, wherever a new opportunity arose. So my challenge was similar. New York was different, and it needed its own kind of sociology. It required new concepts beyond neighborhood and a new method of immersion that wasn't fixed to a particular place since people were on the move. That was the defining fact about people in New York, and the true community seemed to be the sum of all the relationships that they were making while on the move, the many social ties they formed as they crossed the terrain of the city. So losing the idea of a primordial geographic area like a neighborhood would be my first step. So that's really where I began, was to try to think about what it would mean to find New York if it wasn't organized as a neighborhood. Because the work, if you know anything about my work, I don't expect you to, but if you know anything about my work, I write about Chicago communities. I wrote a book about the Robert Taylor Homes. I wrote a book about Washington Park. I believe that people live in communities. So when I got to New York and everyone tells me that we're always on the move, we don't live in neighborhoods, it became very confusing. And so I was trying to figure out, how do you study people on the move? Well, in a funny way, this guy Shine actually became accidentally my first real means of studying these folks that were on the move as well. Shine is black, he's a crack dealer, and around the year 2000 or so, no one was buying crack. People either were jailed, people either died, people either went on to the next new drug, whatever it happened to be, but the amount of people that were buying crack started to decline. So here's a natural question. What do you do if you're a great crack dealer and no one wants to buy crack? You got to do something else. Shine didn't want to run real estate. He didn't want to go work at McDonald's. He didn't want to go work downtown in a corporation. So he decided, well, if I have crack, I have cocaine, because crack is made from cocaine. So let me go and sell cocaine. So who was buying cocaine in New York? Rich white people. So Shine, who lives in Harlem in a historic African-American neighborhood, bless you, like the one we're living in right now, decides he's going to basically effectively go over to Clark and Lake, or Clark and Belmont, or Clark and Fullerton. I don't know. I can't remember my geography anymore. Just imagine that. Here is a Southside crack dealer in Chicago who says, I'm going to reinvent myself by selling coke and going to the North Side and see if I don't get arrested as soon as I get off the subway. I didn't believe he could do it. But the one thing that I did know Here is this person who's trying to make something different out of himself. And this is exactly the kind of story that I wanted to find. So let me read you a little bit about what it was like when I started following Shine as he got off the subway at basically Fullerton and Clark or something like that. Shine had done a great deal of consumer research. Specifically, he'd call all the powdered cocaine dealers that he knew, hung out at parties with his middle-class friends, even tried to purchase coke himself at a few bars to see how it worked. Shine believed that cocaine was mostly sold at parties and clubs or delivered directly to customers at their homes, but he didn't like phone delivery business, and he didn't seem to be attending the right kind of parties. He needed to find new customers in public spaces, upscale bars, hotels, strip clubs, even parks. He had been canvassing a few of these spots with Cohan, another trafficker in his neighborhood who was also losing business, just like Shine. But they were attracting too much attention from security. Once at a hotel bar, they had been thrown out. "Well, what did you wear?" I asked Shine, "when you were thrown out." "Oh, same shit as I have on now," he said. I looked him over. 215 pounds of solid black man in a bright green tracksuit, a baseball hat with a Yankees logo, and a diamond-studded necklace. The Adidas on his feet were white enough for a hospital operating room. "How did you approach people?" I asked. He told a series of amusing stories. Thinking that white men would be drawn to black women, he said, he took a group of sexy young women to a Wall Street bar in the middle of the financial district. The mission of these black women was to flirt and sell cocaine. But the girls were nervous and got so loud and drunk they embarrassed Shine. So next, he brought along a pair of Dominican gun brokers who said that they dealt with rich white people all the time. But Shine's coke made them paranoid, and they threatened to shoot the hotel manager. Going 180 degrees in the other direction, he asked a famous black preacher that he knew to meet him at a downtown lounge on the theory that people who saw them together would trust him a little bit more and he could approach them later. But the preacher was so disgusted at the $10 martinis and he criticized Shine for spending his money in the wrong neighborhood and left in a huff and a puff that soured Shine's whole night. Finally, Shine tried sending the girls back down just to pick up guys and tell them about this great coke dealer that they knew. The ultimate low-pressure sale. But they came back and said that they just flat-out hated hanging out with rich white people. There was nothing to talk about. They felt ignored. So even with a professional sociologist trying to dig in Shine's life, he loved to be a man of mystery around me, which made it hard for me. "One thing you learn in the game," he would say to me, "Sudhir, is that the faster you figure out the whole white people thing," he said, "the longer you stay out of jail." That was the kind of oblique statement that required decoding. So I said, "I take it things are going well?" "Yeah, you know how it is," he replied, motioning to the bartender for a refill. "No, I don't know how it is," I said. "You have to tell me, that's how it works." "Well, put it like this, Sudhir, one day at a time." "Okay," I sighed. "So you're not broke and you're not on your ass yet." "No, but you never know. Don't look for the future because you'll get stuck in the past. That's what my grandma always told me." I shook my head in defeat. He was never going to be straightforward with me. "Okay, all right, Shine, let me see if I understand," I said. "You have maybe, I'm guessing, a handful of clients. You still haven't hired any good contact men yet, but you know you need to because no 300-pound black street dealer is going to sell coke in Wall Street and not get noticed. So for now, you need to keep going to those stupid hotels and bars yourself, exposing yourself. But you hate it. But on the other hand, it's still a new market full of opportunity and you haven't given up." I paused. "How am I doing, Shine?" "Didn't say you were wrong," he said. "Well, I'd say you're maybe at 40% of where you want to be. Maybe you have two bars locked up, a few bartenders, but no hotels yet, because you'd be smiling right now if you did. He smiled, and I knew he was lying. So you're getting there, I continued, but it's slow, and you're burning cash, and you haven't figured out security yet. Something doesn't feel right about these hotel bars, does it? Something doesn't feel right about going downtown, and you definitely don't like walking around with that much of you-know-what on your person. Am I still on track? I asked. Shine didn't even look me in the eye. Now I knew I was nailing it. That's how it went most of the times that Shine and I met. It felt like having a conversation with Deep Throat. But what I really needed, if I wanted to launch a real study, and I always did, was for Shine to introduce me to these bartenders and these bellhops so I could put some meaty details on an application and really start to do it right. So once again, I had to be patient. So this was my life with this guy. So it got me, kind of along the way, and it got me to see something very important for me, because which is that I had been sitting in neighborhoods, literally for months. I would go to the same coffee shop, the same bar, and I would sit as I had done in Chicago. And in Chicago, it was so easy because you sit in Jimmy's, the Woodlawn Tap, somebody comes along, you go back, they're there the next day, everyone has their same pattern. Next thing you know, you write in a book about Jimmy's. This New York pattern didn't work this way if you wanted to study the underground economy, because people were moving in a little different way. And so Shine was really my first glimpse at somebody who was doing something illegally but was moving. He also did something very important to me in another sense, which is that he helped me overturn my Chicago way of seeing people. Because in the Chicago's way of doing sociology, everyone has their box, including the sociologist. You're black, this is your life. This is what you should be doing, and I can predict it. You're white, this is what you should be doing. You're middle class, so on. You live in Hyde Park, so on and so forth. Everything is very neat and ordered. And if it's not, you're the problem, not sociology. New York just throws it all up for grabs, and it makes you really start to question what you're doing as a sociologist, because people don't sit in the boxes that you want them to sit in. The one thing that Shine didn't really give me, which I still needed, was that Shine was someone who was largely outside the system and of a lower economic background. And if I really wanted to tell the story of what was happening in New York and the underground economy, low to high, I needed to get people who were white. And that was proving very, very difficult. So a lot of this book is about me trying to figure out how to do, as what Shine says, to get this whole white people thing. It would happen accidentally, but it would take a long time to do it. And slowly Shine started introducing me to people, and I'd meet more and more folks, etc. One of the most important places I started hanging out was with a group of South Asians, Indians, Bangladeshis, who were running the porn stores and video stores on 9th Ave, 10th Ave, 11th, in the Midtown area of Manhattan. And through that, what I would find out is that they had a huge business that they were running in the back of their stores. Everything was organized around the illegal economy. So you're an immigrant from Mexico and you come up, you can't get a bank loan, you can't get a credit card, but you need $50 until payday. So you go to one of these stores, you borrow $50, but you have to bring your check in at the next pay period, and you have to give them $75. And anyone will recognize these kinds of loans, these payday loans, et cetera, right? So all of these stores were part of the underground economy because they were catering to the needs of people who were immigrants, people who were in need of credit, people who weren't in the system. Slowly, I started to meet more and more folks in that world. And one of the most important parts of that world was that these stores were essentially places where the prostitutes hang out. Again, you have to think about Chicago and New York as being very, very different cities, where prostitution used to be outside. People, prostitutes and sex workers would hang out on a street corner, in the alleyway, etc. Everything had moved indoors in New York. The mayor had shut down the economy, driven everyone off the streets, and they all started hanging out in hotels. They all started advertising, many started advertising on the internet, So the economy was changing. So again, for a sociologist, it becomes very difficult to figure out where do you go to find, you know, this economy. Shine and others, people at these stores started introducing me to people, and slowly I started to find folks who were in this new kind of indoor economy. I want to talk about one more story I want to read, and that is about a young woman named Annalise. So if we have Shine over here, black and low income, on this side we have Annalise, who is white, and who's going to inherit probably $150 million or something ridiculous like that. Very, very wealthy. She's a WASP, a blue blood, as they say, from the Upper East Side of Manhattan. I met her when I was in Harvard for a few years, and she actually helped me negotiate all the fancy eating clubs of Harvard, and she taught me what one says when one drinks a wine other than thank you, may I have another. All the kinds of things that show you that you belong at a place like that. I ended up meeting her in New York, and then the most amazing thing happened, which was that she told me that she was managing prostitutes. Here is somebody who's very low income, Shine, who has to survive, and who does it for survival and does it for a lot of other reasons, but often survival. But you can kind of understand that if you're a sociologist, because that's what people in the underground economy are supposed to do, right? They're out there hustling because they need to survive. Well, why in God's name is anyone with $150 million in their bank account going to jeopardize that, risk themselves, and go to jail if they already are so secure? Why would they do something illegal like that? Both of their answers were the same, which is that they wanted something more than the boxes that people were putting them in. Shine was not a low, down-and-out black man. He was an entrepreneur. And he liked the challenge of reinventing himself. Annalise was not just the daughter of a rich family. She was more than just the name that she came with when she was born. She was her own person. Sounds kind of perverse. It sounds a little off. Well, it was like that for me. I didn't really understand. Why would she do this? Why would she want to risk all of this? And what did she mean that she could be something more than her own person? Slowly, as I started following her, I watched her manage all of these other, mostly very, very rich white women who were similarly giving up the security in their lives and becoming dates for rich men. And they'd make $1,000 a night. They'd make $2,000 a night. They'd go to Paris and they'd make $5,000. You know, all of these women making incredible amounts of money. And they all said the same thing, which is, I'm making my own money. This is not my family's money. I'm doing it myself. So there was a sense of independence that the underground economy gave them, a sense of aspiration, ability to follow what they aspire to, that they couldn't get by just going to the bank and taking out $58,000 at their ATM or whatever they took out for an evening. I have no idea. So let me read you, the last thing I'll read you is about Annalise. And again, I want you to picture now someone who lives at Clark and Fullerton and trying to figure out why someone who was raised there on the Gold Coast would decide to throw it all away and risk all that for a very, very risky life. Why would they do something like that? Annalise looked up, rubbing her hands through her hair. I give these idiots $5,000 a month, no appreciation, she mumbled. Then she made a quick introduction to the two other women in the room. Hey, Kimberly, Jojo, this is Sudhir, she said. Both women had blonde hair with dark roots. Both were dressed casually in sweats and tights and leggings, as if they'd just come from the gym or a revival of Flashdance. Jojo was smoking one of those long Nat Sherman cigarettes. We shook hands and exchanged rote smiles. I work three nights this week, Jojo said, talking about her prostitution openly. I need a break. I'm going to Aruba. Too bad. Mr. X wants you on Friday, Annalise said. Jojo pouted unconvincingly. Apparently, Mr. X was a valued customer. But what about me, Annalise? Kimberly pouted as well. I'm on the phone, Annalise said, waving Kimberly away. Kimberly got upset. What, this bitch gets a full week of clients from you and you can't find me one person? Interrupted once again, Annalise widened her eyes, cupped the phone, and stared at Kimberly and said, those are all return customers, Kimberly. Kimberly stared at Jojo, who laughed and preened a little and said, what can I say? They like my style. Fuck you, Kimberly said, taking a cigarette from the brown box on the table without asking. There was a moment of silence, and then Annalise started talking on the phone again. Hello, yes, it's me. Recognize my voice. Oh, that's so lovely in this day and age, she was talking and blabbing on the phone. When Annalise hung up, Kimberly asked in a sullen voice whether she could go to a Broadway show as well. Annalise had been buying tickets to a Broadway show for a customer. Mercilessly, Annalise shook her head. The tickets are for Brittany and not for Broadway. It's the Met. Kimberly looked puzzled. They're going to a museum? No, to the opera, Annalise said. Her cutting tone made me fear for Kimberly's future as an escort, which snapped me full of awake. All this was so sudden and novel, such a peculiar and fascinating new revelation about this remarkable person that I thought I knew, Annalise. This wasn't some happy little clubhouse for rich kids as I thought it was. You know, maybe I should leave, I said. Annalise frowned. Oh, don't worry, there are no secrets here. Excuse me. Letting out a sigh, I reached into Annalise's cigarette box and picked out a cigarette for myself. Well, if you can't beat them, join them. At this point, Jojo winked at me. Long day, she asked me. I shrugged a little, acknowledging that it had been, and Jojo scooted her chair over near me. Annalise told me about what you do, gangs, drugs, women of the night. Boy, you must have an exciting life. At this point, she actually batted her eyes. She wasn't trying to be subtle. I'm in bed by 9, I said. Well, why are we so interesting to you? Jojo asked me. It's just sex. Sex and money. Oldest things in the world. Yeah, I said, except it's a lot of money. And you're already rich. You're white. You take vacations in Aruba. I bet you have maids. Of course we do, Jojo said. Well, that doesn't mean anything, Kimberly interrupted. Everybody has a cleaning lady. Even my cleaning lady has a cleaning lady. Still, I said, you have so many other options. Kimberly took over at this point. You know, Sudhir, you seem pretty judgmental for a sociologist. I'm not sure why anyone talks to you after you say shit like that. Fascinating, I thought. On the lower economic rungs, the reaction to direct questions like mine is much more humble. But the others I knew didn't have a cleaning lady. Objectively, you have other options, I said to the women. Most of the women I study, well, they don't. Whatever, Kimberly said. Jojo told me that things were complicated, launching into a meandering history of her family that went back to the American Revolution. You know, I went to Yale, she said. I got my degree, I came to New York, I gave up this whole 9-to-5 thing. No thank you, Jesus, that was a living hell. So my dad cut me off. He says it's good for my character. With Annalise now, she was making about $10,000 per month. Are we fucked up? She asked me. Well, of course. I take Vicodin, I snort coke, I get drunk, but who doesn't? You know, I don't see a lot of psychological masterpieces out there. Listening to them made me think about Angela, another prostitute that I knew, and about the problem of the soft skills that Angela didn't seem to possess as an immigrant. Relative wealth and the accompanying sense of privilege gave these women, Kimberly, Jojo, Annalise, something cultural that was really important for succeeding in the world. But what did Jojo and Kimberly think separated from other women? I wondered. If another woman wanted to work for Annalise, what qualities would it have to be? What qualities would it take? What qualities would she need? Jojo began with confidence. Basically, she can't be... She stopped, trying to figure out the right words. Jojo doesn't want to be insulting, Kimberly said. Jojo sat forward. Well, here's what I mean, Sudhir. I was at Zany's the other night. It's a club. It was kind of empty, and I was waiting for my date, and I saw this girl get dumped by this guy. Really weird. He just threw down the money and left. I knew what was going on. She was just like me. She was working as an escort. I could tell, so I went up to her and tried to calm her down, said I knew what this feels like, and after about an hour, she says she wants to leave her agency and ask if I can help. You know what? Not a chance. Why? Because she's a working-class girl. Fucking Julia Roberts. What the hell does she know about ballet or fine art? I mean, you are never just screwing somebody. Sometimes you don't even do that. They have to be comfortable with you in public. And you have to know when to shut your mouth, too, Kimberly added. Those girls, you know, the Puerto Ricans and the white trash, they sleep on bunk beds. Our guys aren't going to trust their reputation to some chick who hangs around the hotel looking for business. Jojo seemed a bit disappointed in me at this point. So that's it? That's what you do for a living, Sudhir? You spend all your time talking with girls like us? No, I usually don't meet a lot of people like you, I said. Usually just Puerto Ricans or white trash. So Annalise starts bringing me into this world, and here's where I'll end. And it started to show me that one of the things that happens, whether you're Shine on one hand or you're Annalise on the other, is that there's a thrill that you get from doing this kind of work. I'm not that I'm advocating it, but there's a thrill that both of them get, which is that they cross worlds, they get these new kinds of experiences, they get out of their station in life, they get out of the place, the box that the sociologist wants to put them in, black, low income, rich, white. And they start moving toward each other in a way. And eventually, as the book starts to describe, they will move toward each other and work with each other. And that's where the book kind of takes you. But the overall book is about really this path that people are on, which is this place that they're going to that's very different from where they started. And for a sociologist, the question for me was, what do you make of a city where people do that all the time? Where it's about leaving the boundaries in your life, about dreaming for something a little bit different than where you started, about trying to end up in a little bit different place. So thank you for coming out tonight. I appreciate it, and I'm happy to hear your thoughts and answer any questions that you might have. Thank you. Tell me your question again. So you're telling me that, I'm just asking it in a question so I can better understand. So the question is about this woman who can do so many other things and she decides to go into this world. I wouldn't agree that this is the simplest thing that a woman could do. I think that's where I would probably disagree. I think there are a lot of other things that she could do that are far simpler. She could, you know, own a food truck. I don't know. She could sell Amway products if she wanted to. But I don't think it's I think this is a very, very difficult kind of operation for her to pull off, and psychologically as well, because she's going against so many of her family's expectations. But high risk, high yield. Maybe.
Similar money, but with much more.
Maybe you're right. Yeah. Do people want a near-death experience? I'm not sure if that's necessarily all of it. I think it's part of it that they want a thrill and they want to be invigorated. But, you know, on the way here this morning, I was hearing on the radio that something like 4 out of 5 Americans are completely unsatisfied with their job and would happily move. So I don't know who's not happy. Most people can't stand what they do, don't want to go to work, and would happily trade their experiences for something.
I wasn't talking about near death. I was generalizing it, that people want filth, and they also want safety.
Yeah.
They also want filth. If it was all safe, it would be boring. There's no filth. If it is filth and too risky and it's too boring, I mean, it's not safe. So they want the safety, but they want the filth also. So okay. They want these opposites.
Yes, that is true. That's right. Yes. You know, I don't know. You may have a point. I don't know about the degree of wealth in New York versus Chicago, if there's more or less. I was struggling to figure out, like, what's the difference. And I think there's a personality that's very different about New York and Chicago. Chicago, everyone's country. Right? We're basically hicks. I mean, Chicago is not the place for innovation, not the place you turn to for innovation, right? I mean, life is country. Everyone's got their neighborhood. Everyone goes home at 5 o'clock. I mean, it's a higher degree of quality of life. In New York, it's how can I step on somebody else to get ahead? It's just a very different feeling of the personality of the city, a different kind of ambition, etc. I don't even know if that's true. That's a stereotype. But, you know, it's a sociologist. You want stereotypes. That's why you hire people like me. Yes.
If everybody who wants to ask a question could come up here to the microphone, that would be great. That way they can get it on the video monitor.
Okay. Professor, in Gang Leader for a Day, you get a notebook with, I can't remember the name of the gang's finances, and that's the kind of thing that would undoubtedly be very useful for police work. How do you deal with the ethical conflicts with knowing a great deal of information that would be invaluable for police to stop, like in this case, cocaine trafficking or gang, gang existence?
That's a great question. There's a presumption in the question is that the police don't know.
Do you have that much faith in CPD?
Faith? No. It's much simpler than that. I have rarely known something that a police officer doesn't know. Police know most of this stuff. They don't. They're not dumb. They usually know. You just have to remember that the job of police in many communities is not to prevent crime. It's to make sure that the consequences of crime don't get worse. So they know who's doing what.
But no, like the specific finances, for example, for bringing, I guess, I hate to say a wire-style investigation, but that kind of thing to systematically tackle the gang.
They know that too.
Okay.
Yeah. I know, it's disconcerting, but they know.
Hi. I'm wondering if you ran into communities at all in New York that people feel stuck in, like whether or not they want to get out. You know, I'm thinking about communities in Chicago like West Pullman and Alban Gresham and Inglewood even, where people have that desire and are not able to make it out. Like, is that true of New York as well?
So I've never really thought about it in that way. I think it's a great question. I've never really thought about people in Alban Gresham as dying to get out and unable to do so. But, you know,
they're literally dying, some of them, to get out. I mean,
yeah, but yeah. I would be careful to say that the people are necessarily feeling like they're trapped. I mean, Auburn Gresham is a lovely neighborhood. It's a lovely working class black community. I mean, it's one of the nicest black communities with wonderful block clubs, et cetera. Now, when you look at it from the outside, it looks, and you read and you listen to the media, right? You're going to get this feeling like, oh my God, how can people live there every day? But I think we have to be a little careful to presume that they're literally just waiting and waiting to leave their neighborhood. The fact of the matter is most people are happy with 99% of life in their neighborhood. They just want little things like, oh, you know, when you call the police, I'd like them to come. And when they don't get that, or, you know, I'd like a full-time job. Most people can handle the shit that goes on in their neighborhood, whether it's domestic abuse, it's a neighbor who's an alcoholic, it's a gang on the corner. I mean, it looks to us from afar like it's very, very challenging and it's very upsetting. But we have to be really careful about making those assumptions, because that gang on the corner is also your neighbor's son, right? So I hear where you're going. I understand this idea, and I think there's a kernel of truth in it. Here's how I would interpret it. Most people in those neighborhoods don't get to come into contact voluntarily with people who live in other parts of Chicago other than in a service capacity.
Sure.
Right? So it's very difficult to say, hey, I'm just going to go to the Belmont Zoo. Just resources may be a problem. They may not get off work. It just may be difficult to do that. It may take too long, et cetera. They may be nervous about going to the north side, et cetera. But I think that's a different kind of mobility than, I got to get out of my neighborhood. It's a war zone. That's the media. Let's be careful about what we hear in the media. It's too easy. It's too easy because you can kind of parrot this view that everyone's in a war zone. It's not a war zone. It's not Iraq. These are nice neighborhoods. They just have some idiots running around who are doing things, and they have people who don't have opportunities. But every neighborhood's got idiots. Right? We all live in those kinds of neighborhoods.
Professor, the work you said you did in Chicago, you said people were more compartmentalized and that they had, you know, you could predict their lives by, you know, their social class. And in New York, they said they were more on the move. Do you think it could be possible that this was more a function of the time that you did the research? Or do you really think there's something inherently different about the cities?
So this is where I think this question that she asked is a terrific question, which is that I think what happens to some degree is that you can have a far greater prediction of where people will end up by knowing where they live, unfortunately. And for someone in Auburn and Gresham, you really do. So in that sense, they're dying to get, when they say they're dying to get out, they may be dying for a kind of a spontaneous life, a life where they're not, they know that there's going to be something that they don't know out in the world. So that is something that I think we need to work on in America, because we're getting into a system of inequality where you don't have a lot of movement anymore across different stations. So when you have that and your life is determined in your social and economic class, you have a very rigid society, and it starts to compromise the kind of democracy you have. That's the thing that worries me more than Chicago and New York.
Thanks, Professor, for coming and sharing this talk with us. I'm actually from New York, so sorry if this is like an insider question. But knowing your past work in Chicago and knowing kind of getting a feel for how like kind of Chicago operates over the past 3 years, it seems like the dichotomy that you're drawing between like upper white middle class and like lower class and black in New York, at least in my experience, has been a very it does. And I'm also like a history major, so maybe in sociology there's a way of accounting for this, but these seem to not work as well in New York, and so I was wondering like what your experiences were outside of maybe just those two separate categories. For example, I grew up in Chinatown, and I knew that there were a series of like hairdressers that operated as brothels if you knew where to go and who to talk to. So like, I guess building off the model of the underground economy, did you have any other experiences outside of those two separate categories that maybe allowed you to help grow those connections or anything like that?
Well, I think in New York, one of the most fascinating underground economies is the immigrant neighborhoods. And that's changed over the last 180 yeah. years. So it used to be, if you look at social histories of immigrants in New York or Chicago, people would start out in their local underground economy, selling things, fixing homes, whatever it happened to be, and then they'd move into a mainstream job in a union or in City Hall. Today, immigrants aren't having that same path. So the underground economy becomes a place where they sometimes get fixed, and they can't, like a hamster on a wheel, they can't get off.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Professor, to echo what the last questioner said, thank you so much for coming out for this talk. I actually read Gang Leader for a Day when I was a prosecutor, and I feel like that should be required reading for anybody involved in criminal justice. I was listening to, you know, what you were talking about in terms of Shine's attempts at economic mobility. If some of these underground economy, sort of vice economies, like I'm thinking off the top of my head, marijuana, prostitution, and gambling, for instance. If those three in particular were decriminalized or had government involvement, don't you think that there's a chance for sort of an opposite effect to happen, whereas Shine today has a little mini business because there aren't a lot of people in the market, but when Walmart starts selling marijuana, you know, at their store, you know, it could really create sort of, I mean, have you speculated as to what would happen to their mobility, you know, if mainstream sort of co-opted their enterprise?
Yeah, you don't need to speculate. There's two places, California and Colorado.
Right.
Where all the people who were, a great majority of people who were working to sell or marijuana, for example, are no longer able to do so because it's been legalized. So they've been they're out of the business. So legalization has actually resulted in job loss for a number of people.
Right.
In a funny way.
And do you know what's happened to them since?
No, I don't know. Oh. I don't. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Professor, what really interests me is how you get these people, like from varying social classes, to sort of open up to you and reveal such, I don't know, deep secrets about their life. So would you attribute this, like, I assume you have a certain amount of personal skill in this, but would you also, like, what does that tell you about these people working in the underground economies and, you know, contrast them with the people in Chicago and New York, or just some general things that you learned?
I'll say two things. The first is that, as Carl Jung, a philosopher, said, the desire to reveal something about your life is much stronger than the desire to conceal. Most people want to talk, even if they shouldn't be talking. So it's not actually that difficult to get most people to talk. What's actually harder is to get anyone to listen. The other part of it is, I don't have any magic dust, any magic fairy dust with this kind of work. It's very simple work. It's just going back. If someone shares something about their life, you go back, and you keep going back and going back, and you always explain to them the research question. I never, ever had to say anything more to Shine or Annalise or anyone else than, here's what I'm interested in understanding. You're rich. Why do you do it? You're a crack dealer. What are you going to do next? They're usually fascinated with the same question. The hardest part is just keeping it simple, I think, because it's getting trust is not so easy, but you just have to keep going back, and you can do it.
Welcome back to Chicago.
Thank you.
So my question is, you question this notion of community, and you said in Chicago we have this set up. I'm an anthropologist, so we pretty much do the same thing. I'm very interested in the comparison between Chicago and New York. There's a kind of nihilism that seems extreme in New York that maybe we don't see here in Chicago. And I'm wondering if you attribute that to the way that you describe the relationships of the neighborhoods. So you said that the neighborhoods here are insular, people don't leave their neighborhoods, and I actually think that's a bonus, and you started off your talking about how wonderful Chicago is. I think my brother moved to New York, and his life got very chaotic, and you know, he's a Midwestern boy, and I told him to be careful. Of course, all the crazy things that would happen in New York happened to him. But I have never heard, or I'm shocked to hear things like, you know, rich girls, you know, going out and prostituting themselves, and sort of the blasé attitude about that. And I'm wondering if you could sort of maybe talk a little bit more about what you think might be happening. Is it because of a loss of community? Can we make those kinds of judgments? And also, what do you think about the nihilism of Chicago, of New York versus Chicago, which, by the way, is an incubator for creativity, because you started here, then you go to New York and get famous, right? So I actually have to disagree with you on that part. But anyway, what do you think about the nihilism? Do you think that has to do with the social structure?
Yeah, I don't know. I do get a feeling that people are just meaner in New York.
Well, they have a lot to compete with,
and
right?
And they like it.
Yeah. Oh.
When you get that many unhappy people together, right? It's great things and bad things happen all day long. Uh-huh. It is very difficult to feel rooted and to have any kind of stability. This is a very Manhattan story, too.
Sure,
I mean,
sure.
If we're outside in the boroughs, it's a little different. Mm-hmm. It's very different to feel a kind of stability in a place like New York, in a society in which we live in today, where the safety nets are going, Our social contract that ties us together has withered. It just perpetuates this idea of everyone, you know, out for themselves. Life becomes nasty, brutish, and short very, very quickly. Mm-hmm. But, you know, New York celebrates that. It's, and so you start to feel as though it's expected of you. New York is a very hospitable place to live if you happen to have $10 million in the bank account. Sure. In your bank. It's a wonderful place to live. If you don't, I'm sorry. I wouldn't go there. No. But I think the thing that fascinated me about Chicago was not, I don't want to say that it's people aren't on the move, people aren't moving around the city. It's that I think there's a way in which you feel like your neighborhood wraps around your identity and tends to define a lot about who you are and what you can be. Sure. There's that lovely Chicago saying, we don't want nobody, nobody sent.
That's right.
Right?
Right. Well, I have a lot of students. We're from Kennedy King. Kennedy mm-hmm. King in the house? Hey. Which is in Englewood. And one of the things I've noticed, not these guys, but a lot of my students have not left the neighborhood, and that would be shocking for a lot of people. I've had students once in a while who've never been downtown. So that rang true for me in some ways. But so thank you very much for your answer.
Thank you.
Not you guys. You guys are tough.
Thanks for coming back. I guess I had two questions specific to your latest book. I know one of the parts that kind of maybe you just manipulated me well, but made me feel a little uncomfortable as well was when you were talking to one of the Johns and how you really, even though you were kind of handed over pretty much easy research, you kind of didn't take it. I was wondering if you could elaborate further why you didn't feel comfortable with that. And second, reading your last book, I was kind of worried about your physical safety. In this book, I was worried about your psychological, like your mind state.
So was I.
So I guess just generally, how are you doing?
Man, you can't buy friends like that. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. Really, I do. That's not a joke. Psychologically, I'm a little worse. I have a little kid, so I'm a little tired, but that's about the best way I can describe my psychological state. Bless you. I'm trying to think of a good way to answer that. I'm trying to think of a good way to answer that first question. Give me a minute. Just let me think about that, will you? Because it's a good question. Let me just give me a second. Let me think about it. Yes.
My question was, I know that in every major city, you know, you have problems or people who deal with the same issues as Shine and Annalise. So what would you say is the fundamental difference between the people who deal with it in New York and the people who deal with it here in Chicago?
Well, I'm not sure if there's a great deal of difference. I haven't really thought about it, but I'm not sure. I think that there's a script to people when they have what happens when things get unstable is that we kind of expect certain things to happen. If somebody gets beat up, we have a set thing, this is likely to occur, this is not likely to occur. When someone gets, they lose their job, we have, you know, so this is going to occur, this is going to, people have a general understanding. They're not as surprised, though they may be worried and anxious as well. So I'm not sure if there are differences in the two cities, but the things that happen in the underground economy is that sometimes you don't know how bad it's going to get. It can just get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse.
Hello. I know most people have, like, real complex, like, questions, but, like, mine's is, like, kind of simple. I really want to know, like, throughout your, like, throughout your, like, period of time you was interviewing these individuals, like, were there, like, any, like, negative reactions or, like, conflicts that happened, like, while you was interviewing them or something?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Get the hell out of my face. Don't come back. Oh, completely. Absolutely. Are you a cop? Are you still a cop? You're not a very good cop. Which is why I said, as I tried to be very, very simple when I was answering that young man's question about what do you do and how do you gain trust, which is if everyone thinks you're going to put them in jail, the easiest thing to do is not to go back. Right. So to convince them, you have to keep going back. So it doesn't matter to me if you're a social worker, a teacher in a high school. I mean, these are like, you go every day. You just do it every day. And even if your students hate you, they criticize you, they throw things at you, they don't listen to you, you go back. And I think that's the real challenge of doing this kind of work, which a lot of people do very, very well and much better than me. But the secret is just, even when they tell you that they're going to, you know, put you, they're going to kill you, they put you in jail, beat you up, which they never really meant. it's just an expression of love. They wouldn't do that to me, would they? Mm-hmm. Kennedy King. Well, they wouldn't do that to me, would they? No, I don't think so.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
How are you doing? My name is Akash. I'm a first-year student here at the university.
Sorry
in
to
the
hear that.
Urban Teacher Education Program, so I'm a grad student.
Okay.
We actually had to read parts of your selections of your book, American Project, about the Robert Taylor
homes. Sorry to hear that,
and,
too.
it was really fascinating to get an account of that history. And one of the questions that you posed in that book, I want to kind of throw back your way, and that's about the Robert Taylor homes, a large public housing complex that was deficient in many ways and was lacking resources. A question that you posed was, can a large public housing project have a sustainable community and have a viable community? And I think that even though those towers have fell, we're still seeing communities that are as segregated, people that are as isolated, communities with rates of disconnected youth that are off the chart, communities that have high rates of joblessness. And I wanted to throw that question back your way. And that's, can these neighborhoods have viable, sustainable communities? And just wanted to hear your thoughts about that.
Yeah, it's a good question. So I do think that they can. I think what they need to, I think what we have is this idea that you give someone a dollar or you give them some philanthropy or charity when they're down and out, and they're going to be, they're going to be millionaires in a year or something. It's just a very unrealistic question or expectation. So when we go into communities, my personal feeling is that we should help people have the status quo. We should have absolutely no expectations that their life is going to improve in some dramatic way. Now, saying that makes you feel like, well, why would I want to teach in a school where people leave me? Or why would I want to go and help a group of farmers if their life is not going to get better? I never said their life is not going to get better. I said you should help them to make the status quo. And by that, I mean you should try and help people get up every day when shit goes bad. Because if you can help them get up every day, that is victory. The challenge for people who don't have a lot of resources is getting up. Falling down is easy. Avoiding falling down is hard. Getting up is extremely difficult. So when I find the greatest way in which people can be of use to others, especially if they come from a background where they have a lot of resources and others don't, is to just walk in and not pity, et cetera, but just simply to say, okay, how is it that I'm just going to help you function day to day to day? Not what is it that I'm going to do to help your kids get into Harvard? It's just totally unrealistic. What is it that I'm going to do to help you feel like you can manage your life? That I'm going to listen to you. I'm going to help you. You're going to fall. You're going to have a problem. You're going to fall again. You're going to have another problem. But all I want you to do is just keep getting up. That's a great skill I think we can all use.
For sure. Thank you.
Okay, I want to preface this by saying that I haven't read your Floating City book yet, so I don't know what you talk about in there versus what you've talked about here. But during your talk, I could understand how the motivations of the two kind of groups of people who engage in the underground economy can be similar. But it was hard for me to understand how the lived experiences, especially in relation to crime control, could compare between the two groups. I have the impression that broken windows policing often, especially in New York, would target activities of the underground economy. But I was wondering if you had insight on how those aspects of formal control, but also informal control, differ between the two sides of this underground economy.
Yeah, well, when people are living in neighborhoods that are generally more wealthy, the police tend to come quicker because there's not a lot, they're not, the scale doesn't really overwhelm people of problems, etc. Mm-hmm. I looked at a map of Roseland recently, and on the south side, and in one month in July, it was ridiculous. It was more than 200 shootings, gun shootings, or something like that. I mean, you can't possibly keep a community safe, completely safe, when people are exposed to that much violence in their day-to-day life. Everyone's going to fail. Everyone's going to have a difficult time, whether they're an interrupter or a Chicago police officer. Everyone's going to be scared. So sometimes it's just the volume in a community that makes it very, very difficult.
But in some place like New York, where people are so mobile, are you saying that, like, if I was, like, in the crack economy, and I just went to this other neighborhood that's much richer, an area that was much richer, like fewer problems around, so maybe police aren't looking there, that I'm gonna not have as many problems?
I don't know if I would make that kind of generalization.
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, but I have to think more about it. It's a good question. I'm sorry, I don't have a very good answer for you. I apologize. It's a very good question, though.
Thank you so much for coming. Your book really problematized the sort of traditional understanding of ethnography and neighborhood as, or like physical boundaries for studying a specific population. How do you think ethnography and qualitative social science methods will change as social networks and the way in which people move through spaces and make connections through spaces change?
Well, it will be very, very difficult to do this kind of work because you're so used to having people let you be around them. And you're so used to having people stay in a particular place. So you've got to try and use different techniques. There's wonderful people who are doing research on the internet. That's a great example where they never even met other people that they're studying. So that's a great example of using technology, following their tweets, following their blog, using email communications. So I think you have to kind of give in and allow that the world is changing, and you've got to go with it, and go with it as far and as fast as you can. Because holding on to that idea like I did was probably my biggest failure, of just saying I'm just going to sit in this place and hope everyone comes to me.
Thank you for coming. I have a related question, actually. Something you bring up a lot in Floating City is the tension in the field of sociology between sociology as a scientific discipline and sociology that holds interest for the general population. So I was wondering as what you see is the future of ethnography and work more of the type that you do in the field in general or in academia.
I think it's a bleak one. The doing the kind of work that I do, students don't get a lot of money. Students don't get a lot of support, they don't get a lot of jobs, and slowly but surely, more people are being told that this kind of work is not very rewarding, and so there are fewer of us that are doing it, unfortunately. So it's to me it's upsetting, because I think it's a very rewarding kind of work when you have to go and be with other people, but in sociology in general, it's not a very powerful way of doing research that can get you resources and things like that, unfortunately.
Yeah, that was the answer I was expecting to hear. It saddens me.
Sorry.
Too. Thank you.
How you doing? I didn't get a chance to read your book, but how did you go about picking your subjects to study, and how did this affect you morally?
They picked me. So there were plenty of people who wanted to have nothing to do with me. And would never, they just left. I couldn't hang around them, they wouldn't call me back. These were people who somehow liked telling their stories to someone for years. So I think we'd have to figure out what is it about that kind of person that wants to share the part of themselves over and over and over again, and try to get some perspective. I mean, just imagine that for a second. It's like a friend in a way, but unlike a friend who probably will judge you and who wants something from you at times, these people just wanted to be heard. That's a different kind of thing.
How did it affect you morally?
What do you mean morally? Can you say more? I'm not sure.
Because, it was the underground economy, and I didn't read it, so I don't know if you told the authorities about it.
No, I never tell anyone.
So how did that affect you, being in that setting? It had no effect?
Well, no, not in any obvious way. I mean, I was studying people who are trying to do something in a world that's very unstable, in a world that is not offering them a lot of help. And so as a sociologist, you have to do this kind of work. You have to, you can't make those kinds of moral judgments if you're going to study people very quickly.
Okay.
You can't do it.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, I feel like I should offer a sacrifice or something. It's quite a strange dynamic. I'm wary to kind of instrumentalize social science, but as someone who is ostensibly a sociologist and kind of an aspiring urban ethnographer, I find myself asking a lot of questions about the purpose of what I am doing and what I may potentially be doing in the future. And it's kind of something that was raised for me when you were quoting from some of your respondents, like when you were saying that she said, fuck you, and picked out a cigarette, and it kind of struck me how bizarre academia is as a space in which it's okay to quote that kind of thing, but it's not okay to act in that way. It's okay to present a kind of attitude of behavior, but it's not okay to break the boundaries of formality, which are part of the practice. And an image that came to my head was kind of that sociological accounts and ethnographic accounts are often kind of like bowls of potpourri that are offered to people who aren't a member of whatever the group is that's under study for them to smell and then put aside. It's kind of sniff in, sniff out. So my question to you is, in your opinion, kind of to what extent is sociology or social science more broadly a bowl of potpourri, and to what extent is it not?
It is, absolutely. I'm extracting from a world where the people that I study have no control over what I do. I'm writing it up, I'm selling books, and I'm trying to make money off that entire operation, and then giving it to people like people in this room who may not be able to go into that world. Now, if I say it in that way, I'm curious to know what are the kinds of images that you have. He's exploiting, he's doing this, et cetera. All I'm doing is defining exactly what we do as academics of this sort. We get information from people, we make our career by getting that information, and then we give it. I don't know how to change that model.
Mm-hmm. So what does that information or that smell, what does that do once it's in the air?
I have no idea what that question means.
Like once you've presented your findings, then what?
Right. So I'm not trying to solve a problem.
No.
I'm not trying to help people improve their lives. None of that. I don't make any claims. The only thing I make that I like to do is that if there are some people who walked in here with a certain view, I hope that I can change it depending on what they were thinking or give them another perspective. What they do with it, it's very difficult for me to control. So they will go out in the world based on this and say he's an idiot, or, oh, that's kind of interesting, maybe I'll read it. I have no idea, but I just have to throw it in the air and let them smell it, to borrow your analogy.
Great. Thanks a lot.
Hi. I read Gang Leader for a Day over the summer for a sociology/policy course here at U of C, and I was wondering, so in Gang Leader for a Day, you reported that some of the people in the gang-filled neighborhoods were okay with the illegal activity, because the gangs often gave back to the community. So I was wondering if you found anything similar in New York, even though the criminals were more mobile.
Very little of it, actually. Yeah, very little of it. They didn't think about themselves as having those kinds of communities, really. If the only people that were like that were the immigrants. So there was very strong networks where they would lend money to each other. They might help each other get a job. They might take you in if you lose your home. Or if your cousin was coming, they could live with you. So in that sense, it was a very rich social network. But it wasn't as though they were going back to Auburn Gresham or Hyde Park or whatever it happens to be and giving in that particular area. So a little different that way.
Thank you.
Last but not least.
Professor Venkatesh, first of all, thank you very much for a really interesting talk. Like a few other of the questioners, I haven't read your book, but after the talk, I'm much more likely to. Thank you. My question is, so someone from, let's say, the economics department or some people in the sociology department might say, here's someone who's in two cities, talked to less than a few hundred people, and is attempting to make generalizations about millions based on that. So my question is, could you talk about the ways in which you think in the ways in which someone could be more or less reasonable in how they try and turn smaller experiences into bigger generalizations and bigger points. What are the reasonable ways to do
question.
That?
I think we're going to run out of time here, so why don't I take all the questions and then I'll try to and answer them. Yeah.
Okay. In your presentation, there were a couple of times that you used this word failure to refer to this project. So one, I was wondering if you could expound on that, and then two, given what you know now about the mobility patterns, as well as other insights you've had from doing the work, the field work that you've done, how would you approach the project differently?
Okay, thank you. Great. Yes.
Yes. So you have described how you've been to, you have studied these two different particular groups. Now I was just wondering, how does one's mortality and belief system change between the race and the gender of people you interact with? And do you believe that the education gap had a major effect on this?
Okay, great question. Just writing it down. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so two sort of short questions. First, have you studied middle and upper class people engaging in the underground economy outside of New York? And if so, are there any differences? Second question, I finished your book and I want more. What comes next?
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry.
So let me take this question about generalizability. And it's a good way to close this. My uncle studies people who have lost their limb, lost an arm, lost a leg. And so I want to draw on his story about what it means to study these kinds of people, that he did this a long time ago. And essentially, the challenge of this question is, I study maybe 3 people, 4 people, 10 people, 15 people, small numbers, and people can easily say to me, as they often do, "Who cares? I mean, who cares? It's only about 10 people, 3 people, 5 people. Why should anyone care about this?" Here's my answer. My uncle has studied this thing called phantom limb syndrome for a very long time, in which people, when they lose their arms or legs, they still feel like they have an arm or a leg that they lost. So someone in the audience, when he was first starting this work, said to him, "Listen, you really expect us to pay a lot of attention to this, do you? I mean, there's not a lot of people with this problem. Why should we care?" And his answer was the following, which is, imagine that I had in my hand a leash, and on my leash I had a pig. And that pig I put on this podium, and it spoke fluent English. It recited a lovely Shakespearean sonnet to you. What would your question be for me? Would you say, "Can you go out and find 2 pigs like that before you tell us how that pig spoke English?" You see how ridiculous that is, right? No, you want to know how the hell is this pig speaking English? I study pigs that speak. And I try to figure out how to make sense of pigs that speak. And it's a particular kind of quest. Go out in the world, find something really interesting, and make sense of it, and figure out whether it has some applicability. But most of all, just try to explain why this pig is speaking English. With that, I have to close, and I hope that you all find your pigs that speak English and try to explain them in your life. So thank you for coming.